Okay. So let's have your math question. Yes. Yes. We are going to compute several derivatives today, but I simply must assume that you know them because this is calculus 2. Right? So there's basically like two sides of calculus. One of them is the differential side. That's calculus 1. The other is the integral side, that which is calculus 2, which is where we are. So I must assume that you have a working comfortableness. But I'll be willing to, I'd be glad to see you in my office. Okay, and so would the math lab. Okay, but we're going to do some today. Okay. Other questions? Okay. So then last time we were solving a particular limit, and we used Horner's scheme to evaluate a polynomial, and my impression of the class was that it was like black magic. So we're going to do several more of those because that's going to be a graded thing. So we all need to be quite familiar with it. So let's go over that. So this is an example. So evaluate P of x at x is 2, x is 3, and x is, say, 5 for this polynomial. P of x is how about x cubed plus 4x plus 9. Okay, so one thing you could do, because this polynomial has relatively few terms, is you could just sort of plug it in the normal way. You could plug it in the usual way with your calculator or with pencil and paper or what have you. But there is a faster way to achieve this, and it is called Horner's scheme to evaluate a polynomial. So the way this goes is we're going to evaluate at 2. So we'll write this little upside down table here. And because we're going to evaluate at 2, I'm going to write 2 right there. And then I need to write something on the top row. What do I need to write on the top row? The coefficients of the polynomial. So what are the coefficients? Okay, not quite. Not quite. 1, 0, 4, 9. Why 0? Because there are 0 x squareds, right? There's 1 x cubed, 0 x squareds, because it's missing 4 x's and 9 units. Okay? So then the way this procedure goes now, the first step is always the same. The first step is that this first number just falls down to the bottom. So it's a 1. Okay? So 1 escaped out of the house, but then 1 realizes, oh, I actually want to be back in the house. But now 2 is guarding the door. So to get back in, it gets multiplied by 2 and becomes 2. Okay. So now you sum this column. What is the sum of that column?
2.
So 2 escaped. 2 escaped. But 2 realizes, oh, I actually want to be back inside. But 2 is guarding the door. Okay, so to get back in, it gets multiplied by 2 and becomes what?
4.
Okay, so now we're going to sum this column. So what's the sum of that column?
8.
So 8 escaped. But now 8 wants to come back. So, but 2 is guarding the door, so to get back inside, you get multiplied by 2, and what is it? 16. And then you sum this column, and you get what? 25, right? 25. Okay, so that's what the procedure is this in and out, in and out, in and out. What it's doing is it's alternating add and multiply. So add, multiply, add, multiply, add, multiply, add, multiply.
What is it called?
Horner scheme. So this is called Horner. Horner's scheme or method or things like this. So a Horner scheme to evaluate a polynomial was originally come up with so that you could evaluate a polynomial. So the answer is that P evaluated at 2 is what? So what is P evaluated at 2? 25. Because that's this number right here.
Okay.
So this number right here. But another interesting side effect of constructing this table is it also tells you a way to break P, the polynomial, into pieces. It's telling you that P of X can be expressed in this way. It's X minus 2 is one of the factors. Okay. And what is what's another factor that I can write right here? So something can be put in here.
1X squared.
Yes, 1X squared.
Plus
2X. Plus 2X.
Plus
8. And where did you get this 1x squared plus 2x plus 8? Yeah, from those numbers, right? 1x squared plus 2x plus 8.
So where did the x minus 2 come from?
The x minus 2, it's always x minus whoever was guarding the door.
Okay,
and now we're almost done. So P of X can be expressed as this thing times that thing, and then now we need one more, plus 25. Okay, so Horner's scheme to evaluate a polynomial does two things. First off, it evaluates the polynomial, and also it tells you how the polynomial factors. So it's telling you two things. Okay, and this now looks like a John Madden diagram, right? Have you ever seen Monday Night Football? Football, right? Okay. We got the fullback, you know, pulling. Okay, no, let's not do it. So let's do the next one. Let's evaluate at 3. Evaluate at 3.
Will there ever be negatives?
Yes, but I specifically chose these examples so that there would not be any negatives because this is the first go-round. Okay, so now we're going to evaluate at 3. Okay, so what needs to be put on the top row?
Same numbers.
Same numbers. Why the same numbers?
Same equation.
Yeah, we're evaluating the same polynomial. Okay, so I'm going to give you about a 5-second head start. And you should be able to beat me. Okay. So now I'm going to do it. And I'm not going to rush. I'm just going to leisurely do it here. So 1, 3, 3, 9. 13, 39, and then what, 48? So do we have agreement? Okay, so then
I even made a little bit of an error. I started to write 29 and I made it 39. But can we all agree that I was able to do it in 10 seconds? Okay, it really doesn't take long to do it. So this tells us two things. It tells us what the evaluation at 3 is. What is the evaluation at 3?
48.
It's 48. It also tells us that P of X can be split in the following way. So what's one of the factors? X minus 3. What's the other factor?
X squared.
Yes.
Plus 3X.
Yes.
So 13.
Okay, good.
Plus parentheses.
Yes, I agree.
Plus 48.
Plus 48. Good. So any question about this?
Will it ever be X plus 3?
If this was a minus 3, if we wanted to evaluate it negative 3, then it would be x minus negative 3. And that would be x plus 3. Other questions? Okay, so that I'll say forget 5 because I'm getting the sense that you've gained some level of comfort with this. So now let's redo that same exercise that we did at the end of last time. And you can see how this technique applies to it. So the question was, please compute the limit as x goes to 3 of, in the numerator, x to 4 plus x to 3 minus 7x to 2 minus 13x minus 6. And then divided by x minus 3. Okay. So this expression, the denominator, evidently has a problem at 3. Why is there obviously some problem at 3? Right, because the limit point is 3, and the denominator is 0 at 3. Okay, so there's something that needs to be done here, needs to be considered. And what we need to address is, well, how about the numerator? Is the numerator 0 at 3? That's less clear, right? Can you what do you get when you plug 0 into the plug 3 into the numerator? Okay, so then when we're going to need to do that, we're going to need to evaluate the numerator at 3. Now, if it evaluates to something like 10, then what is the correct response to this question? That the limit doesn't exist. If it's something like 10 over 0, then the limit doesn't exist. What if the numerator evaluates to 0? Then it's indeterminate, and we have more work to do. So does everybody see that in either case, we need to evaluate the numerator? If only we had some kind of quick and easy way to evaluate a polynomial. Right? That'd be great if we had that. Okay, so let's do it. So who's guarding the door?
Three.
Three, right?
And this is coming from the limit?
Yes.
Because we're evaluating
at 3. Okay, so then this is, so what numbers go in the top row? Good. 1, 1, negative 7, negative 13, negative 6. Okay. So then I'll give you a head start. Okay. So now I'd like to impress upon you just how quick this is when you're comfortable with it. Okay, so then 1, 3, 4, 12, 5, 15, 2, 6, and then 0. We're so happy about that 0, I'm going to make it a smiley face. All right. So
So here I am with a broken hand and talking and everything else, and I did it in on the order of 10 seconds, right? It's not a big deal to do. It's not actually broken. But it does hurt. What?
So you said if it was positive, it would be what, and if it was negative, it would be
one? I'm sorry, I don't understand your question.
If the solution or the final
thing. This one?
Yeah, if that was anything but zero, what would it be?
Then the limit would not exist.
Of either positive or negative?
Right. So this is telling us that the limit is in the form zero over zero, right? This zero is obvious. The smiley face zero was less obvious. Okay?
So that makes it indeterminate, right?
That makes it indeterminate. So that what that means is that we need to factor the numerator in order to proceed. If only we
could factor.
Yeah, if only we could do something about that. Okay. So this tells us two things. This tells us that p evaluated at 3 is 0. And it also tells us that p of x factors in a certain way. So what's one of the factors? X minus 3 is one of them. And what's the other?
X cubed.
Yes.
4x squared.
Yes.
Plus 5x.
Yes.
Plus
2. Plus 2. And now, do we need to, on the other two, we had to write plus something something. Do we need to write plus something something for this one?
No.
Why not?
Zero.
Because it's zero, right? The remainder is zero. So this tells us, that this limit that we're dealing with, the limit as x goes to 3, well, we've just done two things. We verified that it was indeterminate, and we also factored the numerator. So we did all of that at the same time. So the numerator factors like this. So now it's obvious, okay, that it's indeterminate because you see that factor in both places, in both numerator and denominator. So now what? Yes?
I think we went over this last class, but just want to confirm. We cancel that out, but we only do that when we're dealing with limits. Is that correct?
That's right.
Okay.
You can only perform that cancellation inside of the limit.
Okay.
Right. So the cancellation can occur. So this is the limit as x goes to 3, what remains after cancellation. And so then, is this limit indeterminate?
Mm-mm.
No, right? This is just, this is the limit of a polynomial, which is equivalent to evaluating it. If only we had some quick way to evaluate a polynomial. Right? Oh, but we do, right? So 3, and then 1, 4, 5, 2. So 1, 3, 7, 21, 26, 60, 78, and then 80. So what does that polynomial evaluate to?
80.
So the answer is 80. Okay.
How do you write, like, I see that you just did equal 80, but how would you, like, is it, so up at the top you have like P of 3 equals 0.
Mm-hmm.
So how would you write the other side of that 80? Or do you need to?
That the other side of the 80 is this. This.
Oh.
This top one is this one,
is this one.
Okay.
Other questions? Okay. So, Horner scheme. Very good. Okay, some other limit business that we need to know. Is that the limit as x goes to 0 from the left of 1 over x is something, and the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of 1 over x is something. So I will remind you of the plot of 1 over x. So the plot of 1 over x looks like so then, one-sided limits. So we're going to 0. So 0 is, x equal to 0 is this vertical line. So when we go to 0 from the left, so when you get on the red plot and you approach 0, but you approach it from the left side, where does y go?
Infinity.
Down, right? To negative infinity. So negative infinity. So that's saying that on this plot of 1 over x, so this is the plot of 1 over x. As you go to 0 from the left, you go down. Okay, how about as you go to 0 from the right? You go up, right? Positive infinity.
What are the positive and negative signs above the 0?
These ones? This means x is going to 0 from the left. And this is, it's not above, it's in the superscript position. And x is going to 0 from the right. So that's what those things mean. Okay. So let's have an example of doing this. So for example, the limit as x goes to 3 from the left of, say, x minus 4 divided by x minus 3. Okay. So is this limit indeterminate?
No.
No, it's not. Right? So notice that at the limit point, the denominator is 0. But what's the numerator?
Negative 1.
Yes, you have a question?
Define indeterminate.
Okay. The just as a reminder, the indeterminate forms indeterminate forms in limits are things that are in the form 0 over 0, infinity over infinity, 1 to infinity, 0 to 0, infinity minus infinity, and things like this. That's, for this class, that's probably an exhaustive list. Okay, so then the previous example was indeterminate because it was in the form 0 over 0. Okay, so my question to you is this current limit, is this limit indeterminate?
No, this one is 3 in the top.
Okay, good. So this is in the form non-zero divided by 0. What that's telling you is that the answer is either positive infinity or negative infinity.
It's one of those two. Because when you divide something that's not zero by zero, that causes an infinity. But the question is which infinity will we get? Will we get negative infinity? Or will we get positive infinity? And it's not just the question of which one do we get. It's also, and how do we illustrate to the grader and get full credit? Right, blah, blah, all that, right? Good. So let's address that. So this is not indeterminate. So that means the technique to proceed here is a change of variables. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to say that x is 3 plus h. Okay, so I'm going to say two things. This is the first thing I'm going to say. X is 3 plus h. Now, the x and the h are always the same. So it's always x is something plus h. Where does the 3 come from? It's this 3. X is 3 plus h. If the limit point had been 7, it would have been 7 plus h. If the limit point had been banana plus h. Okay? So we're going to do that, and now we're going to take h is going to 0 from the left. So h is always going to go to 0, and the side that you go from, that you approach from is inherited from this one. So this minus is this minus. Okay, so what this is doing, what this change of variables does, is it says, well, instead of something approaching 3, we're going to make something approach 0. Okay, and that will make our lives algebraically easier to do that. So now we're going to compute a limit as h goes to 0 from the left. And what we're going to do is we're going to replace all of the x's with what?
H.
Not h. With 3 plus h, right? X is 3 plus h. So all of the x's must be replaced with 3 plus h. Okay, so now we're going to simplify this expression. So in the numerator, well, 3 plus h minus 4, well, that's h minus 1, right? Because the 3 and the 4 can cancel. So this would be h minus 1. And how about the denominator?
Just h.
It's just h, right? So now that we've performed this change of variables, we can look at this and we can discern two things about it. So at h is 0, what does the numerator evaluate to? At h is 0.
Zero.
It evaluates to negative 1, right? What does the denominator evaluate to?
Zero.
0. So from this, it doesn't equal this. But what this is telling you that the answer is going to be negative infinity or positive infinity. That's what that's telling you. But it doesn't inform you which one. What we need to do to select between these two is we need to consider the sign, the sign. Well, near h is 0,
the numerator is near negative 1, which is always negative. So the numerator is some negative value. How about the denominator? Is the denominator positive or negative?
If it's going from the left, then it would be negative.
Ah, that's the point. So we're going to 0. Now, 0 doesn't have an SIGN. And I'm saying SIGN so you don't think I'm saying SINE, like sine and cosine. Okay? So 0 does not have an SIGN. But that's not the denominator. The denominator is H. So what is the SIGN of H? And she said it.
Negative.
It's negative. Why is the SIGN of H negative? Because we're approaching from the left. If we were approaching from the right, then the SIGN of H would be positive. Okay? But we're approaching from the left, so it's negative. So what is the overall SIGN of such an expression?
Positive.
Positive. This one is how you discern between the two. So it's this one. Okay? So the answer to the question is positive infinite. Any question about this example? Do we want another one of these, or do we want to go to the next thing?
I just have a quick question. So after you decided that x was equal to 3 plus h.
This?
Yeah. And then when you went a step further, when you went, so you said the limit is going to be going to the going to 0 to the left.
Yes.
What made you decide that it was going to go to the left? Is it just always going to be that way?
Because it's always inherited. This was, this limit, the original one, was going to 3 from the left.
Oh, okay. I see.
Other questions?
One more of these,
okay. Is the positive sign in front of positive infinity necessary?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
But I will always write it.
Right, but we're not going to get counted off that we don't.
No. Yes? Sure, let's make one. So, the limit as x goes to 8, okay, and do you want it to go to 8 from the left or right? From the right. Okay, and do you want the answer in the end to be positive infinity or negative infinity?
The opposite of what?
Let's do negative.
You want it to be negative infinity. Okay. What?
I said negative shutdown.
Well, I mean, I've got to satisfy everyone's requests, right? This is it right anyway. So this would be positive. So I need to make this 15. So now it'll be negative. Okay. So is this indeterminate?
No.
No, right? It's not. Because it's not in the form 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity or whatever, whatever. So the numerator is close to 7 at the limit. Yes, you have a question?
Okay, so if we had a bigger, more complex numerator, mm-hmm. would we have to use Horner's law to break it apart to see if it is in the case?
Yes, but I usually don't test such things at the same time. Because what fun would that be, right? Not just it would be unfun for you, because it would be. It would also be unfun for whoever I assigned to grade the exercise. Right? So
that's how you would do it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so then we need to perform a change of variables. What will the change of variables be?
X equals 8 plus H.
X is 8 plus H. Okay, and what else?
H is approaching 0 from
H,
the right.
H goes to 0 from the right. Why from the right?
Because that's the sign of the original.
because it's inherited from this one, right? Right. So what's happening is that you can kind of imagine it like, well, there's an asymptote at 8. There's an asymptote at 8. And we want to approach it from the right. And so what we're saying is that, nah. I'm just going to pull that asymptote over to the origin. I'm just going to pull it just right over to the origin. And I'm going to approach the origin now from the right instead. That's what this is saying. You're moving the asymptote. Okay. So we're going to do this. Change of variables. So now this is the limit as h goes to 0 from the right. And we're going to replace all the x's with what?
8
plus h.
Do we need to make sure when we're showing our work that we're bringing down the limit and h to 0?
Yes. Yes. You need to show all work. So this is the limit. So simplifying this would be what? H minus 7 over H. Okay, so now the two things that we know about this. So at the limit point, what does the numerator evaluate to? Negative 7. And what does the denominator evaluate to?
0.
So non-zero over 0, that's telling us that this must be infinite, either negative or positive infinite. It must be one of those. But this does not inform us which one it is. Yes?
If it's flipped, where it's the 0 on top and 7.
Then the answer is 0. So how do we, this tells us that it's positive or negative infinite. So it's one of these. But it doesn't inform us which. How do we figure out which?
Take the sign of the top, which is negative.
Right.
Sign of the infinite, which is positive. Or to the
right. Right, correct. So this would be positive. So then this expression is negative, so which one is the right one?
Negative.
Good. So the answer is negative infinity.
Why is it negative?
Because negative 7 is negative, so this expression is negative. And how about h? Is h positive or negative? Okay, so is it clear now?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Any questions about this? Okay, so then we can have a joke. So the limit as x... Here we go. The limit as x goes to 8 from the right.
Same kind of problem, or are we moving on?
Same kind. So you should, maybe you can do this in your head by now. So what is the answer?
Positive infinity.
It is positive infinity. So that means... That means that the limit as x goes to 7 from the right of 1 over x minus 7 should be this too, right? Should be like that. Right? You just take whatever number it is and you just turn it sideways. Right? Is that not how this works? He turned the 7 sideways. That's an 8. Sideways. Got some people.
I don't know how to write that down.
That's good.
That's awesome.
Okay. Well, okay. So the other thing that we need to know is limits at infinity. So we'll do just a couple of those.
So how about, pardon me, the limit as x goes to infinity of 4x plus 5 divided by, say, I don't know, 2 minus 3x. Well, what's the answer?
5 over 2?
Nope. 4 divided by negative 3. 4 divided by negative 3. Why is that going to be the case? No clue. Okay. Well, the reason why is that you factor the largest power of x that appears in the denominator out of both. So this is the limit as x goes to infinity of, well, I'll factor out x, so that'd be 4 plus 5 over x in the numerator, and in the denominator, we'd also have x, and then 2 over x minus 3.
You made a statement moments ago.
Okay.
And it said, factor the highest, and then I lost you.
Okay. In the denominator, so this only works for rational functions, which is to say functions that are ratios of two polynomials.
Okay.
You take the highest power of x in the denominator.
Highest power of x, okay.
Which happens to be 1 on this example. And you factor out that many x's out of the numerator and the denominator. So I've done that, and you can see, x over x. Does that cancel? Yes. Why does it cancel?
Because
we're in a limit. So this is the limit as x goes to infinity.
Can you factor out that highest power? Do you just multiply that 1 over x?
It is equivalent to multiplying the numerator and the denominator both by 1 over x. So it would there's 1 over x divided by 1 over x. Yeah. And so now let's look what each of these does in the limit. What does that one do in the limit? That's 4, right? What does 4 do when x goes to infinity? It's 4. Yeah, it's just 4. What is this one?
Zero.
What's the bottom left one?
Zero.
Also 0. What's the bottom right one?
-3.
Right. So it's 4 divided by -3.
Are you going to have to require all that work?
No.
Okay.
not
so
for...
So we can just take the highest power and drop all the rest of it off.
Right. Okay. So... just as a remark, if you go to Google and you type the following nonsense phrase into Google, you'll get a million hits. Does anyone recognize this? No? Really?
It's been a long time.
That's incredible. So, Bobo Botten eats DC. Really? No? Nobody?
Is that a calculus?
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Okay, here we go. This is real, actually. And I mean
can
it.
Can you write that down? Is that important?
You know, well, maybe. Okay. We'll see. So I'll give you 3 examples. This is the limit as x goes to infinity of how about 4x squared minus 5x cubed plus 6x plus 1 divided by 5x squared plus 2x plus 9. So there's one limit. Another one, the limit as x goes to infinity of, I'll just use the same one I used up there, 4x plus 5 over 2 minus 3x and the limit as x goes to infinity of 4x plus 10 divided by x squared plus 1. So here's three different limits and three different nonsense words. So Bobo, the second O is actually a 0. And the letters stand for bigger on bottom. Okay? So then this only works for rational functions where the numerator and denominator are both polynomials. So by bigger, it's meant the degree. So what is the degree of the... So can you find... Is any one of these such that the degree is bigger in the denominator?
The last one.
The last one, right? The last one, the degree of the denominator is 2, and the degree of the numerator is 1. So this one is Bobo, right? So the answer is 0.
Oh my gosh.
If this one is bigger on, if this one means bigger on bottom, then what does this one mean?
Bigger on top.
Mm-hmm. In this case, there's no limit. It doesn't exist. So can you find any one of these where the numerator has larger degree than the denominator? The first one, right?
Yeah.
Because I hid that cube in there, right? Snuck it in there. So the numerator has degree 3 and the denominator degree 2. So this one, the limit doesn't exist.
I just wasn't taught that.
Yeah. Your prior instructor was probably too embarrassed to say it or something, because I'm sure they knew it. I don't know of any instructor who doesn't know it. So how about this one? All right. So this one means bigger on bottom, 0. Bigger on top, no limit. What is that?
Equal something.
Yeah, something like that. Exponents are the same. Divide coefficients. Okay, so specifically what that means is that if the degree of the numerator and the denominator are the same, then the limit is the ratio of the leading coefficients. So what is the ratio of the leading coefficients? 4 over negative 3.
That is awesome.
There you go. Okay, so any question about this? Okay, so one remark is that there is such a thing called L'Hôpital's rule, and if you're familiar with L'Hôpital's rule, its use is expressly forbidden and until we go over it in this class. Okay, which means that if you use L'Hôpital's rule, even if you use it correctly, your response is automatically wrong. If you don't know what L'Hôpital's rule is, then you have no chance of doing it. Okay, yes? By all means, yeah. But it will always be graded as 0. Yeah. Other questions? Okay.
Are we going to have quizzes over review?
Yes. Oh, that's another thing, is that I've two quizzes are available in the testing center, and as soon as they tell me that they're available, because the way it actually goes is I contact them, and then the hamster wheel has to spin a couple times, and then I get a message saying, okay, it's ready, and then I send a message to you. So there's two quizzes in the testing center that I'm just waiting to hear from the testing center about. They are due. You must complete the quizzes by 7 days and 5 hours from now or whatever, Thursday night.
So will we have all the knowledge we need to...
By the end of today, you will.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, even before the class starts, right? Even before this started, you should have been able to solve these particular quizzes because the quizzes are over review.
And can we take them at the same time? Is it fine to take two?
You can take them back to back, yeah. Okay. In fact, the first one is actually trivial. The first one is, how do you take a quiz? Yeah. So
It should. It's really just if you can successfully get to the testing center. Then you can.
I'm gonna guess that's a completion.
It is.
Okay.
The second quiz is interesting. Yes. They're over the previous week. Yes? Three. Yes. Well, no, the completion quiz is just, you just more or less have to sign your name and do the things on the back.
Are they fun?
No. They're not fun. They're not fun, but they're very easy. You'll see. It's not a big deal. Okay, so another thing from calculus one is the average rate of change. Average rate of change. So let F be continuous on A to B. The average rate of change of F on A to B is F of B minus F of A divided by B minus A. So conceptually what this is, so notice that the B's, you know, I don't usually have asymmetric horizontal space on either side of a minus sign, but I'm doing this on purpose so that you realize that the B's line up and the A's line up. Okay? So what this represents conceptually is something like the following. Imagine that we're going on a road trip, a 200-mile road trip, and we complete this road trip in 4 hours. How fast were we traveling?
50 miles an hour.
Okay, so the correct response is that the question is not phrased correctly. Right? Because let's think about road trips. If your road trip experience has been anything like mine, okay, then do you suppose that you were traveling at 50 miles an hour for every instant of that road trip?
Uh-huh.
No. No, right?
That was an average.
Yeah, right? So the way my road trips go is like, okay, let's pull out of the driveway, we go through the residential streets, get on the highway, and then someone says, I forgot my wallet, and then we go back, okay, and then we make it eventually back to the highway into traffic, and someone says, oh, we're in traffic, let's just get a hamburger, and then we get a hamburger, you know. That's the way it goes, right? So then to correctly phrase the question is that if we traveled 200 miles for 4 hours, then how fast were we traveling on average? Okay, 50 miles an hour, right? So that's what this is. The geometry of this
geometry was a long time ago.
All I mean is picture.
Okay. That's better.
So if this is the plot of function f, then what does this expression have to do with this picture? Did you have a question?
What's the CTS mean?
Continuous. So what does this expression have to do with this plot? Well, yes, but something. Well, how are these two connected?
Can you stop
Okay, so then this value right here, the height of it is f evaluated at a, right? And the height of this one is f evaluated at b. Okay, so now this is a fraction, and f of b minus f of a, well, that's how much the function rises. Okay, and then b minus a is the run. So what is this? This is a slope. So if we connect these two dots right here, then we have a line. And this line is so important and comes up so often that it has a name. What's the name for this line? Starts with an S. What is it? Secant line. Secant line. So some of you may be familiar with trigonometry, and there is a trigonometric function called secant, but actually these are not related to each other. What they are is they're both related to something else. So the word secant means to cut, like a section, or you dissect something. Secant means that you're cutting the function, the plot, into pieces. So it's called a secant line. So what the average rate of change is, the average rate of change is the slope of the secant line. Okay. So now, in your differential calculus class, this topic immediately preceded what? It was something else. It wasn't called the average rate of change. It was called, I think I heard someone say it. Starts with I.
Instantaneous
rate of change. Okay, so now let F be defined on an open interval containing C. Then the instantaneous rate of change of F at C is, so it will be F evaluated at C minus F evaluated at X divided by C minus X. So far, it looks just like the average rate of change, doesn't it? Except I'm using different letters. Instead of using A and B, I'm using C and X. So far, it's just the same. Okay, so now I need to add the bit that makes it instantaneous. The bit that makes it instantaneous is we have to compute a limit as X goes to C.
Is. C is.
So this limit business is what makes it instantaneous instead of average. So the geometry of this now is, so if this is C,
this is x. Yes?
So why on the first one did you put B second? And
well, so
you see the difference.
I see it. So let me ask. Algebraically, what would happen if I switched these two, just the denominators? What is that? It would negate the denominator. Right? What would happen if I switched just the numerators? It negate the numerator. So what would happen if I switched both? It would negate the numerator, and it would negate the denominator. So what would change? Nothing, right? It'd be the same. So all that matters is that the B is over the B, and the A is over the A.
So when you say negate, you mean...
Yeah, like... For example, 5 minus 3 is the negation of 3 minus 5. So when you flip them around, moving their positions is negation. So if we flip both of these, if we flip the numerator and the denominator, that's two negations. So that's the same as having done nothing. You may say that it appears there's a difference, and what I'm saying is that there actually is not one.
Okay, so all you did was just negate it.
Twice.
Twice.
Right. I wanted the
denominator.
Right. Okay, good. So then now what this is saying is, again, we have these two points. And we can draw the secant line, but I'm going to draw the secant line dashed because that's not what we're actually interested in on this picture. So what this picture is saying, what this expression is saying, is we're going to take this limit and we're going to take x and we're going to let it go to c. So what I want you to imagine is that I'm going to hold this fence post, the C fence post, fixed, but the X fence post is mobile, so I could wiggle it around. And as I wiggle it around, you would see this point wiggling around in response. And you'd also see the secant line wiggling around in response. So it's mobile. So now what I want you to imagine is I grab this X fence post, and I push it all the way to the C fence post. So I just take it and push it all the way over there so that now there's no longer two points. There's just one point. There's just one point, and you would watch this secant line slide down and relax and settle right here and look like this. And this line is so important that it has its own name. What's its name? The tangent line. So what is the instantaneous rate of change? It's the slope of the secant line. Thank you. Yeah, slope of the tangent line. Okay, and again, there's a function named tangent, a trig function named tangent, but it's not related to this. They're both related to something else. The word tangent means to touch. So this is the line that doesn't cut. This is the line that touches. Okay, good. So this is just fond memories of what you already know. So now let's have an example of doing this. So by the way, how do you quickly compute the instantaneous rate of change of a function?
Take derivative.
Derivative, right? Good. First. Okay. So I lost my train of thought.
You're going to do an example.
Okay, thank you. Find all values of M. So that the average rate of change of F on 2 to 6 is 8, where F of X is 3X squared plus mx plus 4. So find all values of x. No, find all values of m so that this is true. Okay, so one comment I'd like to make now that I've written a few pages of notes and we've looked at it for a minute is that, in case it wasn't clear to you, when I'm writing prose English, I write that in capital letters in an attempt to make it legible to you. And when I'm writing the math letters, I write them in cursive. Right? So I'm not like losing my mind somehow writing F's like this some of the time and like this some of the time. Right? This is a word. And this is the name of a function. Right? Print, cursive. Okay. It's just to help you identify what's what, because sometimes it's not clear. Okay, so then, how do we go about solving this? What do you think? Well, average rate of change. Right? That was on the previous page. That's f of b minus f of a over b minus a. Right? So what we need what are a and b in this exercise?
Two and six.
We need f of 6 minus f of 2 divided by 6 minus 2. To be what? To be 8. That's what we need. If we could arrange for that to be 8, then that would be the answer to the exercise. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to evaluate this. Okay? So F evaluated at 2 first. Let's do that. You could, but this polynomial is so small that you could probably do it. You could probably do it, and I am going to do it directly. So, 3 evaluating at 2, this would be 12 plus 2m plus 4, which is to say 16 plus 2m. And in a minute, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this red box and I'm going to put that in it. Right? But before I do that, what else do I need?
F of 6.
Yes, I also need F of 6. So 36 times 3 is 90 and 18, so that'd be 108. Plus 6m plus 4. So that's 112 plus 6m. And that I'm going to put in this box. Okay, any question about what's going on? Okay. So this would be 112 plus 6m, and now I'm going to make an error, minus 16 plus 2m divided by 6 minus 2.
You say you were going to make an error?
Yes.
Okay. Did you want to distribute the negative sign, or did you want to put the parentheses around it?
Okay, good. So does everybody see that there's an error? Okay. So what has happened is that when I was substituting red boxes for red boxes and green boxes for green boxes, when you perform such a substitution, if what is being substituted in has more than one term, that is to say if it has a plus, or if it has more than one factor, that is to say if it has a product in it, then you need to parenthesize it to make sure that it's right in the end. So these red parentheses that I'm just now putting, before those red parentheses, it was incorrect. Okay, omitting these parentheses is a large percentage of points that students get taken away over the course of a semester. The green parentheses don't change the answer, but the red ones do. Okay, so then this is, so calculating that, that's what? 96, right? No. Yes. Plus 4M. And then over 4. And what do we need this to be? We need it to be 8.
So you can factor out 4.
So I need to divide that in, I guess? Okay, so I'll do that. So that would be what, 24 plus M is 8. So I divided the 4 in, 96 over 4 is 24, 4M over 4 is M. So 24 plus M is 8, so M is what? Negative 16. So that's the answer to the question. When M is negative 16, I'm getting a sad face.
No, you're not. I'm good.
What's the sad face?
I'm just trying to figure
out. Okay. So this 8 is this 8.
Oh, okay.
And then this is this. But when I did the green transition, I divided the 4 in. Okay, so when m is negative 16, the average rate of change is 8, as requested. Okay, good. Any question about this one? So, in case you're wondering, you know, this exercise is, you know, it's all computational. But in case you're wondering what this is, this is a polynomial with leading coefficient. This is a quadratic with leading coefficient 3. How does it open? Up, right? It's a parabola with positive leading coefficient, so it opens up. And there's two fence posts. There's two fence posts at 2 and 6. So they're fixed, right? They're staying still. And what M is actually doing is it's moving the parabola around. And what you're doing is you're moving the parabola around so that when it intersects those two fence posts, the slope is 8. That's what this is doing. And it turns out that when m is negative 16, that gives you what you want. Okay, let's do another one. Now, find all values of p so that the instantaneous rate of change of f at x is 3 is 12, where f of x is px squared minus 3x plus 4. So conceptually, it's a little similar to the previous exercise, except the previous exercise was asking about average rate of change. Here, instantaneous rate of change. So can someone tell me the game plan, the structure of how to solve this problem?
Take the derivative.
Compute a derivative.
And then plug in the x.
Plug in 3.
And make it equal to 12.
And make it 12. Okay. So the strategy is that we'll evaluate the derivative at 3 and then solve equal to 12. So any question about why that's the strategy? Why that must be what happens? This is okay? Okay.
F of x is equal to f prime.
No. F prime is the derivative. Is this prime notation not in common use?
Yes, it is.
It is? Okay.
That's what we
mean. Okay. Okay, so then, what is the derivative then? Very good. 2px minus 3. Okay, so then now we need to evaluate it at 3. Evaluate the derivative at 3. So that would be 6p minus 3. And now what do we need that to be equal to?
12.
12. So 12 is 6p minus 3. So 15 is 6p. So 5 halves is p. I'm not tricking you.
Oh, okay.
this is what it is.
Just a reminder, you take any, I want to say consonants, but that's not right. Constants?
Constant.
Out when you do the derivative, correct?
Well, so constant multipliers, yes. So like the derivative of this term is p multiplied by 2x.
Right.
So I wrote that as 2px. Whereas the derivative of this term, because it is a constant by itself, is 0.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Other questions? Okay, so average rate of change, instantaneous rate of change, terrific. So now we have something completely different for a moment. So now, solve the following nonlinear inequality. I'm going to write a little bit, one more phrase in a moment, but does anyone remember from your prior math classes, probably college algebra, how to solve such a thing? No, that won't work. Okay. And then what? Then you don't know from there. Okay. Okay, so then the way this is solved, solve this with a sign chart. Oh, it's coming. Here it is. Solve it with a sign chart. Okay. So this is the way that you solve nonlinear inequalities. So with a sign chart. So the sign chart is a method that has a number of steps in it. So what's the first step in it?
Google sign
chart. Google what sign chart is. Okay. So the first step is to find the natural domain. What that means is you need to find all of the x's that can actually be plugged in. That doesn't mean find all of the x's so that when you plug it in, the inequality is true. It's just find all of the x's that can be plugged in at all. So are there any x's that simply cannot be plugged in?
Three.
You can't plug in three. Why not?
It's not zero.
Yeah, division by zero is not defined. Any other x you could plug in. That doesn't mean that the inequality will be true there. But in principle, you could plug in any other x besides 3. So the natural domain is anything but 3. The second step. Is to zero and simplify. So we're going to take the inequality that was given, and the first thing we're going to do is we're going to make one of the sides zero. So I'm going to move that one over. So that wasn't too bad. So now we need to simplify the left-hand side. We need to simplify the left-hand side. And what specifically we need to do in this case is find a common denominator. So how will I rewrite this so that it has the same denominator as the other term? Very good. So this will be 2x minus 1 over x minus 3, and then minus x minus 3 over x minus 3. So now they have a common denominator. Now that they have a common denominator, I can combine them into a single fraction. And I'm going to make an error. What error did I make? Yeah, the same error I always make. Okay, so then now this will be x and then minus negative 3, so that'd be x plus 2 divided by x minus 3 is less or equal to 0. Okay, so any question about these algebraic steps? So the next step is now we need to solve the corresponding equation, which I think is probably what you were remembering. So x plus 2 over x minus 3 is equal to 0. So we change the inequality to an equation, and we want to solve this equation now. So how do we solve it? Yeah, so you could multiply both sides by x minus 3, but the right-hand side will remain 0, which is just to say that if this fraction is going to be 0,
then it must be the case that its numerator is 0.
Right. So negative 2.
Right. So it must be the case that x plus 2 is 0. So x must be negative 2. Okay. So any question about this? We want to know when this fraction is 0. In order for this fraction to be 0, it must be the case that the numerator is 0. Whatever, if this is going to be 0, the numerator must be 0 if a fraction is 0. So that it would be like 0 over 8 or 0 over 10. Right? So it must be the case that the numerator is 0. So now, what this calculation has done is it has identified for us two things. It's identified for us this red thing, a break in the natural domain, and it has also identified for us this solution to an equation. So it's identified for us a red point and a green point. So what we're going to do now is we're going to make a chart. A sign chart. And on this chart, we need to plot these two values that we just found. Okay, so now I'm going to make an error. I'm going to plot 3, and I'm going to plot negative 2. Flipped? No, I wrote them the right way. Right? Three's the other way is not a 3.
Oh, negative 2, 3.
Oh, okay. Right, does everyone see that these are not written in the right order? Mm-hmm. They're written in the order that we found them. Okay, we found 3 first, and then we found negative 2 second. But that's not right. However, when students make an error, then they write them in the order that they appear on the page instead of the order that they appear on the number line. Okay. Okay, so now what do we do? We've broken the number line into 3 regions. What do we do with those 3 regions now?
Plug in.
Pick a point. So what's a point to the left of negative 2?
Negative 3.
Negative 3. What's a point between negative 2 and 3?
Zero.
And to the right of 3?
4. Can I ask a question?
Please.
Why is negative 2 not a solid line? Why is it a dotted line?
Because I always write dashed lines.
Oh, okay.
So if you have a style of doing it, that's fine. You can make it solid. But the way that I typically indicate the thing that you're talking about is I make this one open.
Okay.
And I make this one closed.
Okay.
The reason being is that...
But if I do mine as a solid and a dashed line, it's fine.
Just fine. Okay. I write this one open because it's not part of the domain.
Right.
And I write this one closed because it is a solution to the equation. Okay, so then now, what are we going to do with these points? With negative 3, 0, and 4?
Original equation. Make a derivative.
We don't have a derivative.
Oh, no. Sorry.
Not yet.
Original.
We got to plug it into this. This one.
Oh.
Right? The one that has been zeroed and simplified. So you're saying derivative because this you're getting a strong deja vu for something you have to do with derivatives.
Yeah.
But we're going to do that in 5 minutes. We're going to do that. The next exercise is...
What is this technically called?
Solving a nonlinear inequality. Okay, so then now, if I plug in negative 3... into the numerator, then what is the SIGN?
Negative.
And if I plug negative 3 into the denominator?
Negative.
Negative 3 minus 3 is negative.
Okay, now I plug in 0. If I plug 0 into the numerator, positive. And if I plug 0 into the denominator,
negative.
If I plug 0 into, if I plug 4 into the numerator,
positive.
And the denominator,
positive.
And now that we have done this, we can compute the overall SIGN in each region. What is the overall SIGN here?
Positive.
Positive. And then negative. And then positive. Is there any question about the calculation of these? So why do you suppose we call this a sign chart? Yeah, because it's a chart full of signs. Right? That's you know, mathematicians are notorious for using names like that. Sign chart. Okay, so then now that we have this, we can make a conclusion. So to answer this question, we either want all of the positive regions or we want all of the negative regions. So what is it in this case?
No, we want negative, or less than one. We want
all, it's not because it's less than one, actually.
It's less than
0. It's less than 0, right? So this is telling you that we're looking for all of the negative regions. Okay. If I was to go back up to the top of the exercise and edit it and say greater or equal to turn this one around, then this one would be turned around. And I could make it any which way. Okay, so we want the negative regions. And the reason why we want the negative regions is because of this.
When does the inequality sign switch? Is that when you divide by negative?
The direction of an inequality will switch when you multiply both sides by a negative number, or divide, or both sides are positive and you take reciprocals. However, none of that will ever, ever happen in this method. Why not? It's one of the primary strengths of this method that never happens. Why will that never happen in this method? What's the very first thing that we did? We made one of the sides 0 and then did nothing else with the other side. So that entire business is avoided. Okay, and one of the reasons why you want to avoid the entire business of keeping track of switching the direction of the inequality is it becomes really complicated when there's a multitude of factors. By only working on one side, you eliminate all of that difficulty. Other questions? Okay. Oh, I need to answer the question. So, negative. So we want the negative regions. Okay, so then, do we include negative 2?
Yes.
Okay, yes. Why?
Because it's part of the solution.
Right, because of this less or equal. Right. Do we include 3?
No.
Why not? It says less or equal.
It's
not in the domain, right? Okay, good. Any question about this? So now, hopefully you got a very strong echo of something you did in calculus, right? So for those of you who took a college algebra course with an instructor who really stressed this, at that time, it may have been unclear, gosh, why are we doing this so much? It's so tedious. Well, what is that technique used for in calculus? Yeah, making a slope chart, right? So then let's do it. So now the instruction is find and classify all local extrema. For f of x is
x cubed plus 3x squared minus 9x plus 4. So find and classify all local extrema. Well, how do we do this?
Find the derivative.
Yeah, so then we're going to do exactly what we did on the previous exercise, except we're going to do one thing first. We're going to compute a derivative. We're going to compute a derivative, and then we're going to make a sine chart of the derivative. That's exactly what we're going to do. And such a thing is called a slope chart. So the very first step in computing a slope chart is what? There's actually one thing that comes first. Domain.
Oh, the domain.
It's the natural domain. Because no domain was given. Okay, so what's the natural domain of F? All reals. Because F is a polynomial, so you can plug in any value into a polynomial. Okay, now. So your previous instructor, what did they call all the places where the derivative is zero or undefined?
Cut points.
Cut points?
Sure.
That's an uncommon one. What's another one?
Critical.
Critical? That's more common. Is critical okay?
Sure. Call whatever you want to.
Okay. So these are usually called the critical numbers. Critical numbers. Now there's two varieties of critical numbers. One of them is where the derivative is undefined, and the other is where the derivative is zero. So usually I find that instructors don't give these ones names, but I prefer to give them names, right? Because the beginning of wisdom is calling things by their proper name. So the name for a critical number where the derivative is undefined is called a non-smooth critical point. So non-smooth. So in order to address that, we will need the derivative. So what is the derivative? Good, minus 9. Okay, and it is a good idea to simplify the derivative as much as you can before we do any considerations about it, so I'll do that. So I noticed that there's a common factor of 3, so I factored it out. Yes?
I'm sorry, it's going back, but just to confirm, to get the derivative, you're going to take the 3 and move it out, and then you take 1 away from the exponent?
Yes. That's called the power rule.
Okay.
And then this 2 moves forward, so the derivative of x squared is 2x.
Right, and then you times it times 3.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And so does this factor, this quadratic?
Yes.
Yes. So this would be 3 multiplied by x plus 3 multiplied by x minus 1. So for the non-smooth, critical numbers, that is to say, where the derivative is undefined. Are there any?
No.
No.
And you know that because there's not anything underneath. Like there's no way we could get zero in a denominator.
Yeah. Right. This guy. That's basically the long and the short of it. This expression is defined everywhere. Okay. And then there's the other kind are called stationary points. Or stationary critical numbers. This is where the derivative is zero. So we need to solve this expression equal to zero. So zero equal to 3
x plus 3 times x minus 1. So what are the solutions?
x minus 3.
Very good. So, to make a slope chart, you are searching. What? To make a slope chart, you're searching for three kinds of points. Breaks in the natural domain, we found none. Non-smooth critical numbers, we found none. And stationary critical numbers, we found two. So does everybody see that we were searching for these three kinds of points, and we found two? Okay, so now we're going to make the chart.
What? So we were searching for non-smooth. The other one?
Breaks in the natural domain. But there happened to be none.
Okay. So we're looking for where the equation is undefined.
Yeah, where the original function was undefined in the first place. Okay, so now we make the slope chart. We plot these points. Negative 3 and 1. Yes. And I'm going to fill these in because they're both present and accounted for. So now I need to select points in each region. So what's something to the left of negative 3?
Negative 4.
Okay. Between negative 3 and 1?
Zero.
Okay. And to the right of 1?
2.
Okay. So now what am I going to do with these points?
Into the derivative.
Yeah. Because what are we making?
A slope chart.
A slope chart. Yeah. And what informs us about slope?
The
derivative.
No, sorry. Yeah.
If we were making a concavity chart, then what would we be plugging into?
Back into the original.
The second derivative.
Yes, see, I'm guessing.
What informs us about concavity?
The second derivative.
Second derivative being what?
We'll talk about that next week.
Okay.
if we wanted to be making a chart of the third derivative, what's that called?
We didn't go over in calculus one. I have no idea.
No, wait, we did. We did.
It's called.
No, wait, hold on. Because I know it. It's the points of inflection.
That's about the second derivative.
Third
derivative is called jerk. Yeah, I'm not even joking. It really is. It's called jerk. Yeah. And it's called a jerk chart. Well, I wasn't there for the naming of it. Okay?
Okay. So we're here, and we plug it in back into the derivative. Does it matter which derivative we plug it in?
You should plug it into the simplest possible one. So we're going to take these numbers, plug them into right here. So 3. Yeah. 3 is always positive, so I wrote positive. So negative 4 plugged into that term is what?
Oh.
And into that factor would be negative. And into this factor?
Negative.
Okay. So then now, plugging 0 into this, into 3, that would be positive. So plugging 0 into that one would be positive and negative. Good. So positive. And then plugging 2 into that term.
Positive.
Okay. So then now, the overall SIGN in each region. Okay, so what's the overall SIGN of this region?
Positive.
Now, we're making a slope chart.
Yes.
So we need to indicate positive slope. Right? So positive slope is indicated like this. Okay, that's a positive slope, like a positively sloping line. Okay, now what is the SIGN in this region?
Negative.
So negative slope is indicated like this. And then this one?
Positive. are you going to be asking to see our sign charts and slip charts on our test?
Yes.
Got it.
It is what is being graded. Yes? Yes. So if I was to ask you about that little line segment that you can see.
Oh yeah, I know.
It has a positive slope.
Yeah, but using the science, how many people need to love the plus minus minus?
When you plug them in.
So
into the equation.
So you know. Oh, into this?
Yes.
Okay.
No, I understand that part, but from both sides, how do you get
the connection between these two?
Yeah.
Negative times negative is positive times another positive is positive. So maybe it'll help if I do this. So taking these all together, this is positive. Yes? Taking these all together, what is the SIGN?
Negative.
And taking these all together, what is the SIGN? Positive. Positive slope. Negative slope, positive slope. Does that make it clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Other questions? Okay. So, what was the question? It was finding classify all of them. Okay. So, step four here. Conclusion. Find and classify. Okay. Well, were there any local extrema?
Yes.
Yeah. What is indicating that there are local extrema?
When it changes.
There's two things that are necessary. The change in slope is one thing that's necessary.
And that they're stationary.
Well, yes, and okay. I agree with that. So it's this dot, right? Because I could make a change in slope where the point isn't there.
Mm-hmm. And like on the last problem.
Like on one of these. So this is not part of the exercise, but this is something. This is an aside. Is here's a function that's increasing, and then decreasing. That function is increasing and then decreasing, but does not have a relative maximum. It doesn't have a local maximum. It goes all the way up. So, but this function would not have a dot there because this point is not part of the domain. So there's two things that are necessary. The change in slope and that point has to be there.
Yeah. Okay. I don't get it.
Right. So are there any local minima?
Yes, one.
What?
Yes, there's one local minimum. Because you can see that even it looks like a minimum on the chart, right? It looks like a valley. Okay? So this is X is one. Are there any local maxima? Yes, there is a local maximum at negative 3. Even this looks like a hill on the chart, right? Good. Any question about this? Okay. So I hope you see the connection between slope chart and sign chart.
Did we answer that question?
It is answered.
Got it.
What time is it? Okay. So let's have another one. Okay, so I'm going to read the question out loud first, because it's a word problem. Okay, a group of researchers found that people prefer training films of moderate length. Shorter films contain too little information, while longer films are boring. For a training film on the care of exotic birds, The researchers determined that the ratings people gave for the film could be approximated by the following hard-to-believe function that I'll write down in a minute. Find the film length that received the highest rating. Okay, so then in the end, what this story that must obviously be fictitious is saying is that some people were researching how well people rated training videos about the care of exotic birds. Can you believe it? Okay, well, so then there's a function, and we're being requested to find what amount of time did people rate highest. So what are we looking for? We're looking for a local maximum. If only we had some kind of way to chart our way through this kind of problem.
I think we do.
Do we? Okay, good. So there's something about birds and other things. And there's a function. R of t is 20t divided by t squared plus 100. And in the end, I hope that the story is clear that we need to maximize R of t. And we're going to do it with a slope chart. Okay. Yes, yeah, so what is the first step? Natural domain. Okay, so how about that? So how about, would it ever be possible to divide by zero?
No.
No, right? Why is it not possible to divide by zero?
Square.
Right, because t squared, the smallest this could be, is zero. And then we're adding 100. So the smallest the denominator could ever be is 100. So we can't divide by zero. So does that mean that the natural domain is all t?
No, it just means it's all real.
It doesn't mean it's all real.
Greater than
zero, right? What would it mean to watch a movie of negative 8 minutes?
Of your life, you're not
going to
get back.
Right. So, is it clear that the natural domain has to be zero to infinity, which is to say, t must be positive? It's a movie, right? Okay, so then two. What's the second step in the construction of a slope chart?
Derivative.
Right, so we need to find the critical numbers. And at this point, I wish there was some kind of rule to compute the derivative of a quotient.
I think
there is. It's called the quotient rule.
Oh, the quotient rule. Okay. So did your previous instructor tell you the quotient rule jingle thing?
Yes.
Did?
No.
Right.
Low D high.
There you go.
Plus high. Minus high D low.
Oh, yeah.
Right. So you can say
what
if you...
U prime V minus
V. Yeah. You can actually teach us that.
Yeah.
On YouTube.
This is fine. Okay. U, whatever the UV thing. Sure. So if you call this high, because it's in the high position, and this one low, then it's low D high minus high D low over low low, or low squared. Low D high minus high D low?
Prime
D
minus
D
high.
Okay, so that one didn't get a good response. I'll just continue. So, T squared plus 100. So, low D high.
Can you write that out?
So that we can remember it? That'd be
great. Minus high D low. Okay, so that's the quotient rule. So now we need to evaluate these derivatives and simplify. So this would be t squared plus 100. And then what's the derivative of 20t? 20. And what's the derivative of t squared plus 100? 2t. Did you have a question? No?
What does CNS stand for?
Critical numbers.
Yeah, why is your 100 still around on the first one?
Because I only computed the derivative of that. Because it's low d high, so it's this one multiplied by the derivative of that one.
Just because that's the way it is.
That's the quotient rule.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
So then now algebraically simplifying this, so I can see that there's a common factor of 20. So I'll go ahead and factor it. No, I won't. That'll just make it more complicated. Okay. Okay, so then 20... t squared plus 2,000 minus 40 t squared divided by t squared plus 100 squared. So I can see that the t squareds can be combined. So that'd be negative 20. T squared plus 2,000 over T squared plus 100. Okay, now I can see that there's a common factor in the numerator. What can I factor out?
20.
Okay, I'll factor out negative 20.
Or negative 20, because that makes
a difference. Right. So if I factor out negative 20, that's t squared minus 100. And then over t squared plus 100 squared. So does t squared minus 100 factor? Yes. So that's negative 20. And then that's t plus 10 multiplied by t minus 10. Divided by t squared plus 100 squared. So this is, and this should be derivative. Yeah, no one caught me.
Where?
I just changed that one to derivative. But no one caught me before.
We were so excited about the quotient rule.
Yeah, the quotient rule got everyone riled up. Okay, so here's the derivative. Right, but it's been a while, so maybe we lost track. What we were trying to do?
Trying to find the critical numbers.
Okay, the critical numbers. Okay. So how many varieties of critical number are there?
Three.
Two?
Oh, two.
Three kinds of points we're looking for.
Right.
But there's only two kinds of critical numbers. What kinds?
Non-smooth and stationary.
Non-smooth and stationary. Okay, so then the non-smooth variety... This is when what?
Doesn't exist.
Yes, when the derivative is undefined. So having a look, are there any of those?
No.
No, there's none of these, right? Because the only place where there could be a problem is if the denominator was zero, and it never can be zero for the same reason it couldn't be zero before. So there are none of these. What's the other variety?
Stationary.
Stationary. And what is the algebraic condition for a stationary point? Yes, that the derivative is zero. So where is this zero?
Negative 10.
And negative 20.
Oh, wait, hold on.
Okay.
Plus or minus 10 is false.
Okay, so I hear plus or minus 10. I agree with half of these.
Oh, it can't be negative because
oh, it can't be negative because
it can't be negative.
Okay,
negative.
Good. Good.
Tricky.
Right, because t is negative 10 is not in the domain.
So I need to write that only next to it on my test or no?
No, just this would be fine. I'm writing this so that in case anyone looks at the notes later.
Just
yeah, a guy can dream, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So now we're going to make a slope chart. Okay. So I wrote 0 there, and it's a half line, right? Because it only goes from 0 to infinity.
Is it supposed to be slope or is it supposed to be straight? Let's see how it's.
It's supposed to be straight. It might.
Okay.
Anyhow. Okay, so then this is at 10 here. Okay, now I need something between 0 and 10.
1.
Okay. Something between 10 and infinity.
11.
Okay.
Oh, see, now I'm confused.
Why is that?
There just appear to be more. I think I'm okay.
Okay.
Sorry.
So I'm going to copy the derivative down here so I can get a better look at it. So negative 20 t plus 10. T minus 10. T squared plus 100 squared. Okay, so I'm going to plug in into here. So negative 20, well, that's always negative. So negative. And then plug 1 in here, that's positive. Plug 1 in here,
negative.
That's negative. And then we're squaring that, that's always positive. Okay, any question about the sign pattern in the left region? Okay, in the right region, negative 20 is always negative. This thing will be positive. The next thing will be positive. The thing in the denominator.
That only works if I write my signs exactly like it.
Okay.
Sorry. Thanks.
So, in the left region, what is the overall SIGN?
Positive,
right? Because these negatives become a positive, and everything else is positive. So positive, and the slope is positive. So we indicate positive slope. And this needs to be a solid dot because it's in the domain. Okay, and how about what is the SIGN in the right region?
Negative.
Okay. Conclusion. So what's the conclusion? Yes?
The max.
If we were to solve completely for the question where we plug in 1, would the answer end up positive?
I don't understand what you mean. You mean if you were to plug it in and evaluate and get a number?
Yes.
Yes. You would get something. Yes, you would get something positive.
So could you do that too?
Yeah, you could just plug in a number. You'd get some crazy number. Some crazy number, right? So it'd be 1 plus 100, 101 squared.
But it would be a positive number.
It'd be positive.
Yeah.
Right.
It's always positive because it's squared.
Yeah.
So then if we get it, when we plug in 11, we're going to get it negative.
That's right. And it's going to be some crazy number.
But what the reason why we're doing this is because this is a little easier to deal with, and it does not matter what number it is. The only thing that matters is it's SIGN. So what's the conclusion? Yes, the local maximum at T is 10.
Are there two maximums? What I mean is, because you have local versus
global.
Global.
Yeah, there's another variety. That's a different matter. Yeah.
Like calc 3?
No.
I don't know. I mean, we might cover it a little more later, but it the subtlety of it is a little, like there are extrema that can be both local and global. So for example, this is a local maximum that is also global.
So it is important that we write local maps.
That's not something I'm testing.
Okay,
so I still have time. I still have time. We got to. Everybody.
A joke.
It's going to end on a high note.
Do I have one? Didn't I already do like two of them today?
Yes.
Those were small.
Those were little. Okay, so. Do we have anything else? No, we don't. I don't have anything else to cover today, really. Okay, but I do want to make one mention, okay? So take a look at, we just got finished writing an exercise with T's in it.
Yes.
Okay? So take a look at what you wrote. And if your T plus 10 looks like this,
fail.
Then you need to cease and desist. Okay? Don't do that. Okay, this is a T. T's have feet. This is a plus. The fastest way to anger the grader is something like this. T plus T squared plus plus the log of T plus, right?
That's awesome.
Don't do it. Okay, good. Have a nice weekend.